Hello everyone. I would like to welcome you all to our today webinar on securing APIs with WSO2 API Manager and Okta. My name is Sanjay Vanagude. I'm working WSO2 as software architect, and in my role I'm primarily work related to WSO2 API Manager, and I'm overlooking research and development part of that mainly. With me today I have Arsha Diftika, who is also senior software engineer at WSO2, and we both will conduct today's session, and Arshad will mainly walk you through the demonstration and demo part of the webinar. Okay, so this is our agenda for today's session. First we'll discuss a little bit about APIs and API economy. Then we can discuss about the API security and its importance. Then we will discuss what are the different security protocols support within WSO2 API Manager, and overview about supporting third party or the different key management servers. Then we will discuss about integrating Okta with WSO2 API Manager as a key manager. Then we will go for the demonstration, and then we will end up with the Q&A session. So basically idea of this webinar is to give you some idea about the APIs, API security in general. Then we will discuss about API Manager third party key management server support, and why it is needed, and why we decided to do this new implementation kind of thing. Then finally we will discuss about integration of WSO2 API Manager and the Okta. So after following this webinar, you will be able to configure WSO2 API Manager with Okta without any other references or anything like that. So that is the idea, and that will be the key takeaways of that this webinar. Okay. So before moving to next topics, I want to discuss a little bit about API Manager 3.2 release. So if you are already using WSO2 API Manager, you may already know WSO2 API Manager 3 and 3.1 and other versions support third-party key managers. So which means you can configure external OAuth server as a key manager to WSO2 API Manager. So which means whenever you generate applications or the subscriptions and the token generation happens, it will communicate with the external key manager and create OAuth applications there. At the same time, whenever someone invoke APIs with access token, then we have ability to communicate with the external key manager and get that validate for you, right? So this requirement mostly come when you have identity solution in-house. It can be like external identity server or something that you develop internally. Most of the time when we go for the deployment or the architecture view or something like that, most of our users already have some sort of a OAuth server or identity server. So then most of the time this requirement come in, and we have to integrate with external authentication servers or the key managers. So like I mentioned early, so far we were supporting extending this key manager with the customization. So which means we have interface, and you have to implement that particular interface, and then you can establish this communication between API manager and the external key manager. But moving forward from API manager 3.2 onward, we will make it configurable thing. So that means you don't have to write additional Java code or anything like that. You can just go to your admin console, and you can configure third party key managers available there. So for the initial release, we have planned to release product with three different key management support. So that is Okta Key Clock and the WSO2 Identity Server. So these three products will be supported out of the box in API Manager 3.2 release, and we have planned to add some other key management servers as well. So in the future, we will add different key managers time to time and do releases. With this main advantage you get is you don't have to maintain the extension, and also you don't have to write anything. You can simply provide set of URLs and configure the key manager, right? So that is the that is what I need to discuss a little bit before starting webinar. So let's go to slides. So I'm pretty sure most of you are familiar with the APIs and the API economy, but just to make things complete, I will start with the basics. So if we start with the APIs and API economy, sometimes back when service oriented architecture was popular, we had different services, and there are like some applications which consumes these services and data, and people use this application and apps consume the data. So when we do this thing, we had to embed security access control, rate limit, and different other quality of services into services itself. So developers has to work on these quality of services in addition to their real business logic. So then after some time, APIs and integration layer introduced, and with that, security access control, rate limit, all these things handed over to this integration layer. So there were like different products came into market at the same time, and WSO2 API manager is one of them. So we our exact requirement is to, you know, expose your services to your clients in a secured and the more controlled way, and enable a set of quality of services. WSO2 API manager is 100% open source software, and it support full API lifecycle management and policy enforcement, monetization, analytics, usage, data metering, all these things are embedded in our product. So if we discuss about the component overview of WSO2 API manager, if you already use WSO2 API manager, you know API publisher is the place which allows you to create APIs. So that means anyway, you need to create API or manage it, you can go to API publisher. You can start with the Saga, you can start with the Whistle file, or else you can start with the fresh API and continue your design, development, and the governance part there. So then comes API portal, which will mainly take care about like consumer side of the APIs. So basically people can go to API portal, search APIs that they need, and start consuming them. Then there are different runtime components that need to run in order to apply this quality of services. So first one is the gateway. Gateway is the main entry point for your API calls. It will capture your API request and apply quality of services. So you check the security, you check authentication, authorization, then usage metering, all these things happen in the gateway side. So then there are different supporting components. So key management server is one, which will take care about the security side. Then comes the traffic manager, which take care about the rate limit and other stuff. Then analytics server will take care about the business and runtime analytics data. So today in this session, we are primarily focused about key management. So that means mainly gateway and the key manager. And for this key manager, we are trying to externalize to some other product. So that is what we are going to do today. So then if we take a bigger component overview, then like I mentioned earlier, API store and developer portal, you can see in the left side, mostly API developers, application developers engage with that. Then we have gateway, micro gateway. Then we do have Istio support. So if you are like having large service mesh kind of deployment and you still need to use the API management there, then this is the right solution for you. And if you are having Kubernetes deployment, then you can use that. And your backend services can be microservices, legacy services, or it can be cloud services, or even serverless or Lambda kind of services. So all these business services are supported. So then if you have any mediation requirement, then we have enterprise integrator. So with that, you can do the payload modification, different routing policies, and if you want to like aggregate messages and build some complex logic, then Enterprise Integrator is the right product for you. And we do have Identity and Access Manager, which take care about the federation, single sign-on and adaptive authentication and other stuff. So that is the bigger component overview, which connected other products as well. Okay. So then we'll discuss a little bit about the APIs and API economy. So in a recent report, it was mentioned Expedia is generating 90% of their revenue through API. Similarly, eBay generates 60%, Salesforce generates 50%, and Stripe reported to generate their complete revenue through the API call. So likewise, you can see this API is becoming more and more important, and most organizations directly generate revenue using the API. So APIs are now very critical and directly impact your revenues and the business operations. So so there are some other reports. So one is the Akamai survey report. So in their report, they have mentioned if we take total internet traffic, 83% of them are API traffic. So that with that, you can imagine how many API calls happen within a day kind of thing, right? And similar to that, in another Imperva report, they have mentioned two-thirds of all the organizations are exposing their APIs to public and partners. So with that, you can think about the importance of security, because if two-thirds of the large organizations expose their APIs to public and partners, they have to be very serious about the security. So that is another factor. And in the Gartner report, they have mentioned by 2022, API abuses will become most frequent attack vector in the web. So this is again predictable, because when people attract to APIs more and more, and when they consume more and more APIs, then hackers will also attract the same, because they know most people are using APIs and a lot of transactions happen with the API, and they also invest heavily on this area, and they also do certain kind of attacks through the APIs. Okay. So if we discuss about the importance of API security, so whenever some kind of attack happen, usually there can be operational level disruptions, and also it affect to your brand name, and it can like generate negative publicity, and there can be complicated legal problems. And also, if people know your systems are vulnerable, they could do the repeat attacks, and then they can compromise your suppliers and your customers' data. Also can be leaked to different parties. So like then API security is kind of a very serious matter. So then in order to have a proper API security mechanism, you need to know about your strengths and your security measurement and all these things. So I would like to pull this slide. So in this slide, so Sun Tzu, he's a like famous author of the Art of War book, and he said, if you know your enemy and if you know about yourself, you can win any battle. So that means you have to have proper understand about the security measurement and the security related stuff within your organization. And if you have a better idea about your attackers and the other people who are trying to attack your system, then you can easily win this battle. Okay. So then when we think about the API security, you have to think about like OWASP top 10 security vulnerabilities. And if you take WS2 API Manager, we can address all these listed vulnerabilities. So we have done a separate two videos. If you are interested, you can refer them. So in this session, we are not going to discuss detail about the complex security mechanisms and the security vulnerabilities and how we address them. But this is just to give you an idea about the importance of API security. And at the same time, data protection laws and different protocols like PoPI, GDPR, these things are getting popular. So with the API management product, you can perfectly position API gateways to address most of these requirements. So we'll not go into detail about these things, but those are again basic requirement of API gateways these days. Okay. So then if I discuss about the API manager, different security mechanisms we support, we can split this into two parts. First one is the static security. Then next one is the dynamic security. So if we consider the static security, we do support SQL injection, different pass attacks we can detect, payload attacks we can detect, and if they are like open API security violations or vulnerabilities are there, we can detect them. And schema violations we can detect, SSL, TLS kind of like transport level security things we can address, and also API implementation and contract mismatches also we can support. Then if we consider dynamic checks, we can think about rate limiting, throttling API calls, authentication and authorization, anomaly detection, AI-based threat detection, real-time protection with the gateway firewall kind of thing also we do support. So this is the overview of WSO2 API Manager Security. Like I mentioned earlier, static and dynamic security policies are there that covers payload scanning, access control, these things. Then we do have like AI-powered threat protection, and also they are like API security, open API vulnerabilities also we can detect. So this is the overview of our security support available in WSO2 API Manager. So then I'll discuss about the WSO2 API Manager's external key management server support. So first I'll discuss a little bit about the role of key manager. So usually API key manager handle all the clients and the security and the access token related operations. So as example, we can think about access token generation, access token validation, all these things done by the key management server. So in a typical API manager production deployment, different component talk to this key manager. If we take a gateway, and whenever requests come to gateway need to communicate with key manager to validate this access token, because key manager having this authority to check tokens that you send. So gateway communicate for the validation purposes. At the same time, if we have developer portal or the API consumer portal kind of thing, whenever people start to consume API, they create different applications. It can be auth application or different kind of application. And also they can generate access token. They do the subscription. There are like different things they can do. So whenever these subscribers do these things, we need to communicate with the key manager underlying, because if customer says, I need to create application, then we need to create auth application in the key management server side. And whenever they request access token, we have to communicate with the key manager and get this token on behalf of the user. So likewise, these things addressed by the key manager. So when subscriber generate access token, like I mentioned earlier, it need to communicate with the key manager. So there are like different things that key manager do in a real production deployment. Okay, so if we try to understand API key manager usage, and if you are not that much familiar with the auth, let me take another example. So I'm sure most of you are familiar with the SACML. In the SACML, we do have different parts, right? So we have PEP, policy enforcement point, policy decision point, policy information point, policy administration point. So basically with the administration, we create different policies. Decision point is the one which takes the main decision. Information is finding additional information to make this decision kind of thing, right? So if we take API management and the key management world, you can identify a policy enforcement point somewhat similar to API gateway. So API gateway is actually kind of a policy enforcement point. So then rest of the component play the role of key management server. So now you can understand OAuth or the WSO2 API manager. Key management server means all these capabilities, basically policy administration, policy decision, and the policy information. So this is the one example that I took to, you know, explain usage of this schema. So then next part, Arshad will cover. So we will discuss about how this integration works with the Okta, and then we will see the demonstration as well. And if you have any questions at any time, you can ask in the chat. At the end of the session, we will answer these questions. Arshad?
Yes. Hi, everyone. I am Arshad Diftika. So I'll just take you through how we manage integrating Okta as a key manager within our product. So in this slide, you can see I have included two diagrams. So here, what I'm trying to convey is an idea of how we take decisions in this space. So in first diagram, you can see how we handle the introspection scenario. So for an example, if someone, let's say, generate a token from Okta and then tries to invoke an API, and then when our gateway gets the token, our gateway should know to which key manager the gateway should contact for the introspection. So the way we decide this is that going forward in the demonstration, I'll show you these step by step, but we have given the ability to, when configuring a key manager, you can define some sort of a regex or a pattern so that we can identify each token separately in the gateway. So that's what I have covered in the first diagram. So when I'm going through the configurations in the demonstration, I'll show you, but it's better if you can have idea on that before the demo. And another point I wanted to show was that the consumer app creation flow. So in our demo, we'll be creating an application in Okta through our dev portal. So I needed to touch that area on how we make decisions in that logic. So when someone tries to create an application, we first check whether a key manager exists. So let's say someone tries to create a consumer app in Okta, but we first check whether the admin have configured such a key manager with the API manager with the API manager setup, and then next we check whether the consumer app creation is enabled in the key manager configuration. So even this one I will go through when I go through the configs. So in the configs, we allow you to define whether you need to create consumer apps through API manager, or you will be provisioning already created applications. So here we check whether consumer app creation is enabled, and also whether all the required parameters are provided in the key manager configuration. So only if these criteria are fulfilled, only we will be creating an application. So yeah, so this is the thought process and the logic basically we go through mainly. So let's go to the demo then. Yeah, I'll share my screen now. Yeah. So as you can see, we for this demo we have prepared a trial account in Okta, and so basically for someone to configure Okta as a key manager in the WSO2 API manager, then one of the main requirements is that they need to first have an application in Okta by which they can configure the application credentials in WS2Site. So basically, what we do here is that when someone gives these application credentials in our configuration, we use them to invoke the token endpoint. So that is one requirement. So let's go ahead and create application. Let's click on create new. And in Okta, basically, you get different types of applications, web, native web, single page applications, and auth services. So for this purpose, we'll need a auth service because this will be backend to backend communication. And we'll go ahead and create one. And we'll name this webinar. Okay. Right, so you can see that we have created application and we have got credentials for this application. So we'll get back to this later, and we'll then go to the next requirement. We also require a API key to be generated. So here under security, you get API, and under tokens, you should be able to create a new token. So here I'll just say webinar token. So I just copy this and leave it here for the moment. Right. Now let's go to the admin console. So for this demo, we'll be using the latest pack of the API manager, which is the 3.0 version, which is to be released in a few days' time. So yeah, so this is the admin portal. So those who have used WSO2 products before might be used to a different type of admin portal before, but from this release onwards, we have revamped this UI with much more richer options and configuration. So here, in addition to the previous configurations, we have new entries such as the key managers. So let's go and see there. So by default, we have a resident key manager defined. So this resident key manager utilizes our identity server product and its components to deliver this. So in addition to this, we'll be defining Okta as well as a key manager. So let's go ahead and add key manager. So this is basically the UI. And here you can see that we have two different fields. We have a name field and a display name field. So basically the name field, in the name field, we need to enter some sort of a name that can be used as a key. So here, for an example, I'll give Okta KM, but for the UI purposes, we'll be showing the display name in almost all the places. So here, I'll just define as secondary, as is a secondary key manager. And you can give a description. Yeah. I'll just give a sample message. And here you can select the key manager type. Now for the moment, we support only WSO2 identity server, key cloak, and Okta. But in the coming few weeks, most probably we'll be releasing more key managers, and we'll be continuing to release even after that according to the requirements. So we'll go ahead with Okta. And going to the next configurations, you can see that we have a bunch of endpoints here. So admin who is going to define this section have two options. Either they can manually give each endpoint or use a well-known URL to populate these URLs. So in this case, I'll be using a well-known URL. So let's go and So here on the authorization servers, I'll be using the default authorization server of Okta. Copy this. Right. And now we have imported the endpoint. So you can see that we have populated the issuer. And we have populated each of these endpoints using the well-known endpoints. So Okta calls this well-known endpoint as their metadata URL. So in this case, let's call that. And the next part we need to configure is the claim URLs. So basically what we need here is the consumer key claim URI and the scopes claim URI. What we try to accomplish by getting the consumer key claim URI is to find out by which key we can extract a consumer key from a token. So in Okta's case, by default, we'll be using CID, which is the claim we'll be getting. And for scopes, it's SCP. So if it's different, you can always configure other values here to match your implementation. And then you get grant types. Here, these are supported grant types by the key manager. So even this field is populated using the well-known endpoint. So if you are manually configuring, you can of course enter all the grant types your specific key manager is supporting. And next is the certificates. So here as well, we are given options. So you can either upload a certificate here, or you can use the JWKS endpoint, which is populated using the well-known endpoint. So if you are not using a JWKS endpoint, you can always upload your certificate that can be issued. So now we come to our configuration part, where we configure the credentials. So as you can remember, previously I generated API key from Okta, and it should be here. And I will enter that. And let's also provide the client ID and the client secret we generated previously. So on the applications, webinar app is the app we created. And let's copy them. And the client secret as well. Okay. So then we are coming to the last section, which is the advanced configurations. So here, basically, we have given a granularity where you can define much more specific tasks. So here we give you the option whether your specific application needs, through the dev portal, should give the ability to generate tokens. So for an example, I'll be touching this sector when I'm demoing the dev portal UI we have implemented. But just to give an idea, here you can select whether you will allow token generation through the dev portal for this specific key manager. And here you can say whether this key manager should support out-of-band provisioning, and if this key manager should support auth app creation through the dev portal. So in this case, I'm going to untick out-of-band provisioning, as I'm going to demonstrate the auth app creation part through our dev portal. And we also get the token validation method, either self-validate JWT or use introspection. So here, this introspection is not for opaque tokens, but as Okta doesn't support them, this is for JWT. So let's say some admin needs to send the JWT token to Okta so that it can be validated there instead of within our gateway. They can configure this and it will function that way. And but for this demo, we'll be using self-validate JWT. And moving on to the next part, it's token handling options. We have three options here: reference, JWT, and custom. Under reference, you can define a specific pattern. As I explained in the previous slide, the last slide we discussed, the reference token, you can define a specific pattern to a reference token so that we utilize that pattern to identify which key manager this token is from. So under JWT, you can see that we can give a claim key and a claim value. So that, let's say for an example, you have a claim key saying key manager type and octa. So you can just say key manager type and octa so that we can find out, okay, we need to check this key for this value to identify this key manager. So by default, we have already implemented this for the default scenario. So for an example, now we have already implemented internally a logic so that our gateway is aware which key manager this is from. But if you are deviating from the normal behavior and customizing claims and stuff, be mindful to define these values here. And we also give an option called custom, where you can write your own implementation. That will be a Java implementation, so that you can extend our key manager implementation and write your own mechanism to identify and distinguish key managers. So we have given the ability for any amount of configurability. And the last configuration will be claim mappings. So most of you might know about this. We can map remote claims to different local claims. But in this demo, we'll not be using that. So let's save this and go to the next part. I'll be adding the key manager. So you can see that now we have the resident key manager and the Okta KM defined. Now let's go to the publisher. The publisher UI. So, okay. So here I have already deployed the PizzaShark API, which is our sample API we have. And under runtime configurations, those who have used the 3.0, the API manager product, from the 3.0 release onwards should be aware of this UI. But here you can see under application level security, we have this basic set of configuration which we had previously. So for those who haven't used the API manager publisher before, I would like to first introduce this area first. So basically, this is where all API creators come and API developers come and develop their APIs and then publish to the dev portal. And the dev portal will be the area where application developers come and subscribe to these various APIs. So here you get all the information here, and these are the specific settings we have for this given API, and the runtime configurations are all the runtime configurations that need to be configured for this specific API. So let's go back to this application level security window. And here you can see we have the O2 basic or API key option, but this is where things change. So we now have this key manager configuration section. So what happened here was that all this time, our API manager didn't actually need this sort of a setting, because we always had only one key manager defined. So when we implemented multiple key managers, what we did was that we gave the API developers the power to decide which tokens, that means which key managers can generate tokens that can invoke my API. So that power is given to the API developers. So they can select allow all. In that case, both resident, Okta, TrailCloak, any key manager can provide tokens to invoke this API. But for this demo, I'll be ticking only Okta key so that I can demonstrate this scenario. And you get all the other runtime configurations here. Yeah. So let's save this and proceed. Yeah, it saved successfully. Now let's go to our developer portal. Yeah. So here you can see our API. First, let's go and create an application. Let's call it Webinar Dev. Let's say Webinar Dev and save this. So under auth tokens, so those who are used to the API manager UI should see a major difference here. We now have different tabs for each key manager within IP, within application. So you can see the resident key manager have its configurations here where we can generate keys. And we also have the secondary key manager. So as you can remember previously, we added secondary as the display name, which is used here. And under here, you get different types of configurations. So the configuration and information. So for someone, the application developer or a user to see the token endpoint, the revoke endpoint, we have given these values here. And of course, the application developer can select which ground types he need to allow for this application. So in this case, let's go with all the ground types and give a callback URL. And as you can remember, we went through four different application types in Okta side. So we have given the same set of types here so that you can you have the configurability of any type here. So if you mention web here, the client generated in Okta will be of the type web. So for this demo, I'll be using a web type application. And the response type also can be defined. So here I'll be providing all three so that the application created, I mean the client created in Okta will support all this. And for the token endpoint authentication method, I'll be giving client secret basic. So this is also a different, another configuration which is supported by Okta. So if someone needs to go with some other type of token endpoint authentication, they can do so. And I'm going to generate keys. Right. So once we generate keys, we get a access token along with application credentials. So here you can see we have a consumer key and a consumer secret, which is masked. Right. And now let's go and try to invoke our API. So first of all, let's subscribe to our PiezoShark API. Yeah, we are successfully subscribed. So now we should be able to go to the PiezoShark API and try it out. So for those who are new to the developer portal, basically once someone comes to the developer portal, actually a developer comes to the developer portal and access the API. He is first given all this information, how he can, what are the URLs he should use to access them, and what are the resources you get, and all that stuff. If SDKs are given, you can generate them, or needed, you can generate them, and you have all these options here. So I'll be going to the tryout window. So what we do through the tryout window is that you can test out this API using this window. So here I'll be giving the token which you generated previously. to be used to invoke this API. So on the menu, I'll be accessing this menu as it's a get endpoint. So here you can see that I invoke the menu resource and I got a successful response. So this is because we allowed Okta as a allowed key manager for this API, and the resident key manager not so much. So let's go and create a token using the resident key manager. So it's generated. Let's go back to the API and try it out. I'll execute, and you can see that we don't allow you to go through the resident key manager. So this is the granularity we have gone in the configuration perspective, and this is the functionality we have implemented for this scenario. So that will be the demo. So if you have any questions regarding this or the whole webinar, please make sure to drop it in the questions tab of the GoToMeeting panel. Thank you.
Okay. So so there was one question already raised. So so we will send recording and the slides within a week. So due to any reason, if you miss anything, don't worry. We will send the recording and the slides within a week. And also we have planned to release API Manager 3.2 within next few days. So once it is released, you can try it by yourself. And if you have any questions or anything like that, you can contact us through our Slack channel or our developer mail threads. So to answer questions, so there was a question about, they said they had some in-house developed key management server, and they asked about the feasibility of connecting that to API Manager as a key manager. Yes, it is doable. So with this new implementation, if it is not out of the box supported one and it's your own implementation, what you have to do is that you have to write a connector. So connector means we have provided a set of guideline, and with that you can write your own connector, and you can then plug that to WSO2 API Manager. Then WSO2 API Manager will be able to communicate with your key manager and get all the application related things and do the token generation, application registration, and all these things. And there's another question. Is it mandatory to support DCR and DCRM? So actually DCR and DCRM support is not mandatory. If you have some sort of mechanism to, you know, create applications, create auth applications and populate them. So if even if it is a kind of a SOAP API or anything like that, not really required to comply with the DCR and DCRM specification, because they have like very specific request format, response format, and the message payload kind of thing. So even if you don't have that kind of support, you can still implement your connector to successfully communicate with your key manager. So even if it is have a SOAP API, REST API or web support API or anything like that, we can let that complexity to handle by connector side. So basically what you have to do is that you have to write the connector and plug that connector. So answer is you don't have to have a DCR or DCRM support. And also if you have your homegrown key manager, you can easily connect it. So let me go to other questions. Okay. Yeah, so there's another question. So are there any courses to learn WSO2 API Manager? Yes. So if you go to WSO2 API Manager training site, there are like plenty of materials available, and you can refer them. So you don't have to, you know, pay or anything like that. You can just go to training site. So there are like self-paced training. So with that, you can learn basics about WSO2 API Manager and how it works, different components and the scalability, deployment planning, all these things available freely. You can go to wso2.com/training site. Then once you go there, you can select API Manager. Then from that point on, you can start learning by yourself. Okay, so there's another question. So is there any guidelines for the custom key manager in the help docs? Yes, so this new feature comes with API Manager 3.2. So once API Manager 3.2 release available, you can see them, all the guidelines and all the things. So basically we have planned to have a different kind of documentation. So one documentation is to help you to learn how you can write connector. Another documentation page to understand how this key manager, third party key manager works. And another one to list all the steps that Arshad followed here. So if you have already implemented one within your deployment and you need to configure it, then you can refer that document. So all these document will be, three type of document will be available in the next release in the documentation page. Okay, so how soon we can expect documentation for the new version available with the samples? So like I mentioned early, within the next few days, we will do the release. So most probably by next week, you will have documentation and other information required. So by the time we send the webinar recording, we will include documentation link as well. So you can refer that. Let me check any other questions. Okay, there were other questions about the, that is again about the documentation sample, like I mentioned early, within next week that they will be available. Okay, so there's another question. Is there any restrictions to certificate or the algorithm strength that you use? So to answer this, so if you are doing the key manager in the key management server side, then we don't have any restriction as such, because key manager is the one which is communicated with the third party key manager. So that implementation can be anything. So we can use any kind of algorithm. So any mechanism to authenticate with the third party key manager or the external key manager, that is completely up to us. So I think we don't have any restriction as such. Okay, so there's another question. This version available as a Docker? Yes, by the time we announce the release, we will make all this available as a Docker artifact as well. So once we send the release note, you can go to our 3.2 document page, and there you will find a link to Docker images. Okay, I think we don't have any more. Okay, there's one other question. So there's another question. Can I use Okta configuration for Azure Active Directory? Configuration for Azure Active Directory. Now, if you have Azure Active Directory, then most probably you will have to write a separate connector for that. Let me check how involved it is. Upgrade. Okay, so there's another question. How this is involved with the upgrade to existing versions to API Manager 3.2. So if you are already on API Manager 3 or 3.1 or any other previous version, then we do provide the migration support. So once you do the migration, then what you have to do is so if you have already implemented third party key manager as extension point, what you have to do is you have to convert that to connector. So that is not complicated, because previously if you already implemented third party key management extension, then what you have to do is that you have to implement the API manager key manager interface, and based on that you have already done some sort of implementation. So what you have to do is convert that to connector, and then put that connector back in the place and do a small configuration. So we will provide the guideline to convert this already implemented key manager extension to key manager connector. If you have any questions related to this, you can always contact us through Slack channel, or you can use our developer mailing list. Okay, which is the latest version of WSO2? Is an open source? Yes. So WSO2 API Manager last release version was API Manager 3.1. So we will do the API Manager 3.2 release within a week or so. So that will be the latest version, and it is open source software. Okay, so there's another question. Do we have any reference to developer connector? Again, yes, we are working on that documentation. Soon, once we done with the release, we will update the documentation page. So like I mentioned earlier, by the time we release webinar and the slides, we will send the link to that as well. Okay, so there's another question. If we use WSO2 identity server, do we need a connector? So simple answer is no, because we do have plan to support WSO2 identity server as a out of the box key manager that we support. So like I mentioned early in this presentation, we have initially planned to support three different type, Okta, KeyClock, and the WSO2 identity server. So you don't have to do anything related to. Okay, so there's another question. So is there any dependency version for WSO2 identity server? So if you take identity server 5.10 version is the compatible one for this particular release. Okay, I think since we are running out of time, we will have to stop from here. So we will record all the questions, and we will write the answers for these questions and send them along with the webinar recording that we send to you all. Okay, then thank you very much everyone for joining today webinar. So within next week we will do the release. You can download the pack and you can try it, and we would like to see your feedback and other suggestions and others your opinion on this feature and generally related to WSO2 API Manager 3.2. So stay connected with us through the Slack and our mailing threads. And thank you very much, everyone. Have a good day.